I'm going to get started on the introduction here because I might be a second longer than Dr. Giordano is used to for this. So I could not decide on a good way to introduce Dr. Giordano, and so I'm going to introduce him in several ways. For this audience, I'm going to start with a little bit of a professional interpersonal introduction. I'm going to admit that I have strong radical behaviorist leanings, which means that while I love neuroscience, I'm extremely skeptical of the word neuro being attached to any other word after it. I'm also rather suspicious about work on ethics. While I understand the importance of work on ethics, I also realize that a lot of bad things happen when that work is done poorly. And so my expectations for a field called neuroethics were not initially very high. While I still have mixed expectations about the field, for some reasons that you can see the good and the bad and the ugly is in the title, I'm very happy to say that Dr. Giordano's work in particular is very, very good and doesn't hit any of my sort of instinctual knee-jerk concerns that have been inculturated into me. I have a temptation to introduce him in a bit of a more informal, familiar kind of way, to mention things like his second degree black belt in judo, that he set a couple of speed flight records, and other things like that. Jazz pianist in his spare time. But it might be better to introduce him by his academic credentials. He'd gotten 3 master's degrees, physiological psychology, philosophy of psychology, and biopsychology, before his PhD. And even after earning his PhD, after about, what did I calculate off of your CV? 26 years after earning the PhD, he returned and got a Master's of Science in Biomechanics and Kinesiology. And a few years after that, earned a degree, a graduate certificate in bioethics and health policy. So his background is extremely broad, and his ability to go back into new disciplines to bring the information that he already had and his expertise and bridge that over to new fields is quite impressive. He's taught at Hunter's College, Hopkins University, Drake, the Marine Corps Aerospace Training Center at Cherry Point, Lamar University, University of New Mexico, Gallaudet, University of Buffalo, and his primary affiliation for the past 12 years has been the Georgetown University Medical School. At that location, he's a professor in the Department of Neurology and Biochemistry, chief of the Neuroethics Study Program at the Pellegrino Center, co-director of the Pellegrino Program in Bioscience and Global Health Law and Policy, has been a distinguished visiting professor at several institutions, a Fulbright scholar at several institutions, a position as a research fellow in the European Union Human Brains Project, and in addition has around 270 published works, including 9 books, mostly on neuroethics and health policy, and increasing work on national security from that perspective. So when countries start investing in neurotechnology and other sort of biomedical modifications, how do we think about that from an ethical perspective, including a security perspective? So you all are in for a treat. He's an excellent speaker, and happy to and privileged to introduce Dr. Giordano.
Thank you. Thank you, Eric. That was a wonderful introduction. Thank you all for coming on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. I was hoping there would be miserably hot and humid so that I would say, oh, great, you're in a wonderful place, but I really appreciate that you're here. It's a beautiful day here in D.C., and so hopefully you'll get out and enjoy the weekend. And hopefully I won't bore you over the next 40 minutes or so. And, you know, let me by virtue of introduction, let me always start with 2 apologies. First and foremost, I like to apologize. This is not a speech impediment. This is a New York City accent. I was born and raised there. I've been out of the city a long time, but this is the best I can do. And number 2, the title, I think, really explains part of my background, as Eric did a wonderful job in telling you. By training, I'm a neuroscientist. I'm a brain scientist. And I'm here to tell you that the neuro prefix is badly misused. I, too, agree with that. Those of us who do interventional brain science and theoretical interactive brain science recognize that the field is largely bastardized, very often outside of the silo of those of us who do it within academia. But these are days when information is let out of the bag rather quickly, and I think there's a real problem that goes along with that. Hence, the need for a field that is going to be something of a watchdog over what neuroscience not only does internally, but also, I think, keeps its finger on the pulse to guide and govern the ways that neuroscience is used, misused, and may, in fact, be appropriately used, not only in those ways that are technically right and apt, but also trying to get a handle on those ways that might be good, which then opens a proverbial Pandora's box of what the good means, but also what the bad and the ugly mean. As in my introduction, again, I'm very grateful for, a lot of the work that I do, in full transparency, has been funded by the Department of Defense here in the United States, but also, and concomitantly, by the European Union Human Brain Project, where I head the sub-program on dual-use brain science. Dual-use, as you may be aware, coming out of the Asilomar conferences, connotatively, has a brain of its own, connotatively has meant military use, but more and more we're looking at the brain sciences to be dual use anywhere outside of the medical silo. And more what we're finding is that brain sciences are indeed being offered both direct to consumer and increasingly, not cryptically, in a do-it-yourself market. And I put that forth early in this lecture because I want you to be aware of the profundity of the brain sciences to extend from the bench, basically to the bedside, to the battlefield, to the boardroom, and beyond. And in each and all of these extrapolations from the relative rigor of the research and biomedical forefront, what we tend to see is drift off the proverbial center line. That said, we're here at the APA convention, and I think one of the things that becomes important for us to understand is that the intimate dance between the brain sciences and psychology has been somewhat indeed fortified from the initiation of psychology as logos. The idea of looking to behavior as a window into what may be happening on the mind is as old as perhaps humanity peering into a reflecting pool and going, what is it that makes me me? If we look back to antiquity and we look to the work, for example, of Socrates, Aristotle, Lucretius, Galen, certainly these thinkers' thoughts were focused, at least in part, upon the essence of human thought and what that means. Anime. Psyche, bring these things now forward several hundred years, obviously the major turn occurring in and around the period of the Enlightenment, based upon at least a strong part Rene Descartes' formative, I think, therefore I am, the cogito. But the corollary of the cogito is, what is it then that makes me think? Fast forward once again a few hundred years to the work in the German laboratories and here in the United States with the work of William James that looked at psyche as growing out of that field of ethology, behavior, and the intimate relationship that exists between what happens here and what happens here. But as we took the physiological and mechanical turn that essentially defined the 1800s into the 1900s, and we embraced the 20th century, more and more, those understandings of behavior, of cognition, of things that we'd like to essentially, in quotes, refer to as the mind, that are indeed the focus of psychology, turn to more underlying aspects of how it could be that psyche arises from a physical body, and things neuro became ever more prominent. I've been a neuroscientist since the late 1970s. I basically grew up with the field. The field called neuroscience, titularly, arose in the late 1970s, but indeed, understandings of the brain, a concatenation of the basic sciences, the medical sciences, looking at what makes the brain tick and how it is that that thing in your head may be at least in part responsible for the thoughts, emotions, and behaviors that come out of it. Well, certainly, this has been the dance, if you will, the wonderful waltz of psychology and brain sciences. And like so many dances, there may be a bit of tension in who leads and who follows. And I think the issue there is it's not so much a competition, but I'll put forth early in this discourse that this should be more and more of a cooperation. And my thesis is simple. The more we learn about the brain, the more we need psychology. And moreover, I think that the guiding aspect of that needs to exist somewhere in the triangulation of psychology, brain science, and this other field that I'll introduce momentarily called neuroethics. But let's not overemphasize either one of these fields, neuroscience and neuroethics, in terms of their roles and their responsibilities, but rather in their capability to execute balance. As I have you here in the slide, essentially neuroscience is indeed an approach, it's a tool. that can be applied in a variety of disciplines that psychology claims is its own. Certainly the biophysiological, psychological sciences, experimental psychology more and more relies upon those techniques that engage and interact with the brain. And certainly cognitive psych, social psych, occupational and clinical psychology, and perhaps asterisk clinical psychology even more and more these days. Because as you know, there is a very strong tendency, a push and a push back, where clinical psychology interfaces with the iatros of psyche, which is psychiatry. And there's a fuzzy boundary that exists between what represents clinical psychiatry and what it does, and particular ontological claims of medicine that might define or misdefine what psychiatry does. And some of that is seen in the psychopharmacological debate. But if we move beyond that just a bit and get down into the proverbial weeds of neuroscience, what I'm here to tell you is that neuroscience has indeed, over the past 50 years, and certainly over the past 25 years, made tremendous developmental leaps. Many would call them advances, and I think there is some debate about what's an advance and what's a leap, to understand how nervous systems and brains are structured and functioned. And those functions very often can be categorized into these sort of broad sweeping terms that we like to ascribe to this thing called mind. Now, if you'd allow me a bit of Aristotelian departure for a moment, I think what the brain sciences have allowed us to do quite well is to understand certain aspects of brains and their function. In other words, formal causality, if you would. How is a brain structured? How does biology and biological systems engage the process that we then come to know as the workings of neurons as cells and glia as cells within this structure we call a nervous system and brain? What is the material substrate, and how does the material substrate give rise to certain functions, and we know how nerve cells work? But that's where we stop. We come precipitously to the end of this, and we say, well, we know how the cells work. We know how systems work and networks work, but we don't understand how the great stuff of thought, emotion, and behavior arises from the gray stuff that lives in your head. This is Chalmers' proverbial hard question or hard problem, and it's one that essentially we confront in a variety of ways, and in some cases we sidestep, because what we're able to do is assemble patterns of neurological function on a variety of levels, from the synaptic all the way to systemic, and from these things infer certain things probabilistically about what these mean for our behavior as individuals, groups, and perhaps even as populations. So what we find is, as we see here with the thinker, we may be able to understand certain things about brains, but there are other things that remain the challenge for us, the question for us, and how we then approach these utilizing the techniques and technologies we have at hand. And what that really allows us to do is to take a look at what neuroknowledge is. Like any other form of science, it is wedded to its philosophical construct in that its epistemology has to be self-critical and self-revising. I'm here to tell you, I've been a brain scientist for almost four decades. There are things that I learned in school that have been proven to be wrong, not as insular single facts, but as constructs that are important to the contextualization of the way we know brains work. One of those things that I learned in school is almost sacrosanct was something called Dale's Principle. And for those of you who may be my age, 60 years old, you may think, oh yeah, I remember Dale's Principle. One neuron can produce and release a single neurotransmitter only from its terminal branches. What that created was a construct that was pretty much toe bone, foot bone, leg bone in the way a neurological system has worked. And through our tools and our techniques, what we've come to realize is that's not true at all. Far more heterogeneous, far more complex function, even at the cellular level, which then gives rise to a much more complexified function when we then begin to link those cells together into nodes, networks, and systems. So what we're seeing is that neurological knowledge, like any other scientific knowledge, is indeed iterative and contingent upon what we know and what we don't. But that's within the relatively insular silo of the academic rigor that defines neuroscience qua science. These are days when those types of rigorous boundaries no longer exist. The fact that we're able to communicate by virtue of the internet, the fact that we now have open access journals, and the fact that even the news media, the general media that has been covering sciences for years, may not necessarily be fully populated by individuals who are just science reporters. The idea of the good story and the competitive story has now spread out a little bit more broadly into a wider population of journalists. Not that are any less capable at all, but certainly are not necessarily operating only within the confines, silos, and relative sanctity of scientific reporting. What that has led to is neuroubiquity. You cannot swing a wet rope over your head without seeing a brain image that says, this is your brain in love. This is your brain after a breakup. This is quantum consciousness. We see these things all the time. In fact, the idea that Eric just promulgated, the neuro prefix, I think is promulgated widely and very often inappropriately. But what it really does is this type of ubiquity also tends to provide a bit of misinformation. Because what it falsely ascribes is what we know about the neurological systems and what we don't know about the neurological systems. And this is what the philosopher Roger Scruton, I think so adroitly, has referred to as neuro-nonsense. Roger's a wonderful guy, and we spent some time together at Oxford. He has a great English accent, and when he says it sounds absolutely fabulous. It's neuro-nonsense. When I say it, it sort of sounds vulgar, because I think it is vulgar. I, too, like Roger, stand very strongly against the idea of neuro-nonsense. We have to make some sense of what the brain sciences teach us, and we have to make some sense of what we know and what we don't. Because the problem here is these misinterpretations are not singular misinterpretations that just lie within the brain sciences. We impart meaning to these things, and then we use these in what is sometimes referred to as the mechanistic paradox. We need to know that something works a particular way to believe that it does, but then we make a story up and we go along with that and we use it anyway. The other thing we tend to suffer from is what's referred to as Icarus folly. That is to say, we have a sense of hubris about what we know and what we don't, what we build and what we can build, and how we use these things. And even though we may hear the warning, we may not always heed the warning, where the limitations are, where the capabilities are, and the difference between. And I think one of the issues that goes along with this is indeed the ubiquity of the brain sciences per se. And I think the quote here by Wilder does a great job. Where you get too many people together, you're bound to get something nonsensical. But what neuro does, what I would urge neuro to do as a prefix, is to sort of stand as synecdoche. If we talk about Wall Street or Main Street, we're not talking about the street per se. When we talk about neuro, we're not necessarily talking about neuro things per se. What we're really, really doing is we're talking about the field. What do we know? What do we not? What do we do with the information we have at hand? And what do we do about the information we don't? And how can we move on from that? So the issue here is to balance these contingencies in such a way that makes us understand that when we say things are neural, or the word neural basis of, what we're doing is two things at the same time. We're trying to peer through the dim and defuzzify, a real enough word, defuzzify those things that are loose at the boundaries. But at the exact same time, we're opening up proverbial Pandora's box. Because when we open the box to knowledge about things neurological, we also let loose the demons and gremlins of what that information means vis-a-vis knowledge, vis-a-vis the way we use knowledge, and our sophistication, and I think the probity of the way we go forward with that. Look. Anytime we talk about neurological knowledge, anytime we use neuro as a prefix, there is some presumption. There's something definitive and reductive about that. I've been a neuroscientist for over 35 years. I'm pushing 4 decades doing this. And I'm here to tell you, anyone who absolutely can explain to you how it is that mind occurs in brain, stick with that person very closely and make sure you go with them to Scandinavia to pick up their Nobel Prize. Look, we simply don't know. That doesn't mean that we're not trying to know, but there are some of us within the neurophilosophical community that say we simply can't. We can't look that closely into the actual thing itself by using the tool that is doing the job. Brains perhaps can't understand brains. Perhaps it's an engineering problem. This is much of the work of the philosopher Colin McGinn, who aligns himself with a philosophical orientation called mysterianism. It will always be a mystery. McGinn's come around a bit, and he said, no, perhaps we're now on the cognitive crest or cusp of being able to understand that, and perhaps engineering and artificial intelligence may be helpful in that. Or perhaps the toolkit that we develop may be instrumental for us to get deeper insights to how it is that soupy, sparking cells are able to give rise to this thing as phenomenological consciousness. But we're not there yet. And as a result, what we need to understand is, despite the fact that we have acumen in many of these techniques and technologies, many of these things are nothing more than well-baked theses and not necessarily full theories, some being more mature than others. But what becomes important then is to understand that anytime we put the neuro prefix on anything, particularly things that relate to cognition, emotion, and behavior, that we use in our social sphere with regard to the interaction of individuals, groups, and populations, and we leverage this in the forefront of medicine, society, and beyond, each and all of these things must indeed be based upon facts, real facts, and open to incorporate new facts as indeed we engage that relative dance of new tools giving rise to new theories and new theories that then provide the basis to develop ever newer and more sophisticated tools. These are referred to as gigerens of heuristics, the idea that I have certain tools of knowledge and capability that allow me to formulate certain theories, subject these theories to testability and falsifiability, come to certain conclusions about the parameters of these theories, then build ever newer tools to explore these deeper and deeper in greater granularity. In balancing those contingencies, enter the field neuroethics. The term neuroethics was first bantered around in the 1980s and realistically became somewhat more formular, more popular, if you will, when it was used in the early 2000s by William Safire, the late William Safire, the New York Times columnist, at a Dana Foundation conference. It caught on like flame on dry brush. Suddenly, neuroethics as a term was on the lips of not only those individuals in academia and the intelligentsia, but literally society at large, the public. Neuroethics. If we take a look at the cognitive scientist and philosopher Adina Roski, she defines the field as essentially having two major foci. The neuroscience of ethics, which is actually inappropriate, it just sounds sexy to say it, is not the neuroscience of ethics. Working with my colleague, Professor John Shook, we've looked at that in a little bit more detail. And what we're really seeing is that this is sort of the neuroscientific basis of things that individuals and group putatively define as morality. It's neuromorality, if you will. And really what it is looking at the neurological basis of how humans and other organisms exist within the relationships of their ecology. It's a nice admixture of cognitive and social neuroscience and cognitive and social psychology. In many ways, it's looking at the biological basis for our interaction of deliberating and defining what is good. And that could be extrapolated to a variety of levels going all the way from what is good on an interpersonal level to what is good on a group and population level and can be extrapolated to things like ethics and law, certainly. Biological basis of how we make these decisions. Some interesting information that comes out of that, and I'm happy to talk to you about it offline. The take-home message very quickly, spoiler alert, is that the way we do moral cognition is not much different than the way we do any other kind of cognition that has important referentiality back to ourselves and our relationship with others. There is no nucleus moralis or tractus ethicus in the brain, but there are some very discrete pathways that are involved in the way we make certain types of decisions, and I think that's important to understand. It doesn't reduce morality down to a particular brain site, nucleus, or network, but it does help us understand how brains work. It doesn't tell us what the good is or even how to be good, but it certainly tells us how our brains negotiate that, respond to it, what stimuli are important, and perhaps how to engage those brains in such ways. But before we can look at a brain or engage the brain in any way at all, you have to ask yourself two questions. Number one, are you doing it in the right way? Are the tools and techniques you have at hand accurate, sophisticated, important, valid enough to be able to then be viable in use and of value in their application? Because that value may in fact be extrapolated on the social sphere. Oh, this is very valuable if we get this type of information from these types of inputs of technique or technology, but the validity of it may be lacking, and as a consequence, you're using non-veridical information. False facts, if you will. We can't go there with the brain sciences because there's too much based upon that. So what we then do is we see this second focus, the ethics of neuroscience, which really is bipartite. It's looking at the ethical basis of how we do brain science. Every ethics begins from fact. What do we know? What do we not? What will we do with what we know? And what do we do with what we do not know? And what we can and cannot do. It also questions those areas that neuroscience has put into its spheres of application, not only in medicine, but increasingly in the public sphere and in a range of different social discourses that range from the interpersonal to the political. My argument is quite simple, although there is some implied order that the first, quote, tradition or focus is the neuroscience of morality and the second is the ethics of neuroscience, I say that these are quite different. There's really an interactivity and reciprocity here. I say you cannot or should not do the first, the neuroscience of anything, without engaging the second, at least concomitantly, looking at the ethical basis of how you're doing the neuroscience or any science and how you're putting it to work. And I think those two things need to be marching forward in step. And I like the word in step, integrated science, technology, ethics, and philosophy, in step, moving together that way. So if we then look at what neuroethics is, definitively it's a branch of ethics. It uses many of the methods that ethics uses, ethical methodology. It's certainly an area of bioethics because it looks at a life science, brain science, and its applications in ways that affect the lives of those things that are the subjects or patients of its moral regard and its practical use. But there's also something perhaps unique about it. What may be unique about it is that the substrate of its focus remains plagued by the hard question that we don't know how it works. We don't know how brains give rise to, evoke, channel, generate, or antennize mind. And as a consequence, what we really have to do is recognize what we're really working is pattern probability. It keeps the neuro thing synecdoche. It keeps the neuro prefix conjectural. And in that way, neuroethics in some way allows it to sort of be a self-referential model. It is both a lens that allows us to look at the brain sciences and brain, and a mirror that allows us to look back on ourselves as humans and other organisms, and look back upon the brain science and its methods. So it not only allows us to look into what neuroscience is doing, it lets us look reflectively back and say, are we, as the people who develop and use neuroscience, doing it in ways that are both right and good? But the argument about neuroscience and neuroethics is really one of not only its value, but its value is predicated upon its validity, the validity of brain science and the validity of neuroethics to be able to guide, if not govern, the brain sciences. And our argument is that neuroethics is valid if and only if, the philosophical double F, it is, number one, realized to be naturalistically grounded. It doesn't deal with things supernatural. And the reason I tell you that is important because there are some who've begun to leverage the neurosciences with regard to things that border on the super paranormal. I think there are plenty of things that may be paranormal. When we begin to talk about a neuroscience of religion, we can't apply the neuroscience of religion to taking a look at the neuroscience of a particular deity, and I don't care what deity that may be. It could be a large cat playing with a ball of yarn somewhere in the universe. I don't care who you worship. There are certain things that fall within the ambit of what can be scientifically studied and other things that cannot. Can we study the way brains, for example, respond to religious or spiritually inductive events and perhaps even develop some of these rituals? Yes, absolutely. Does that tell us anything more of an eschatological nature? No, it does not. Moreover, in that naturalistic grounding, we're bounded by the techniques and technologies we have. We can only study the natural world. Therefore, we have to base any extrapolation upon the facts that we have at hand. Nothing more, nothing less. But those facts also change as a consequence of the tools that we have. They get ever more sophisticated, granular, and perhaps they are actually canceling each other in some instances. What we used to think things worked A, B, C, we don't think that anymore. And as a result, it too must be self-revising. Not only must the science be revising, not only must neuroethics insist that the science and its uses be revising, but neuroethics must be flexible and revisionist. And it must appreciate that humans and every other organism that has a brain that is embodied in that organism and embedded within its environment. I simply cannot be a completely frank reductivist. And the reason for that is simple, because we recognize that brains do a lot of things and organisms work biopsychosocially. So neuroethics as neuroethics must in fact appreciate a biopsychosocial application. Yes, brains do a lot of things, but I'm not looking out of a field of a bunch of neurons. These are in bodies, and these bodies are nested in their ecologies, and those directionalities go in both ways. And in that respect, it must also be culturally appreciative. Why? Not least the reason being that neuroscience is an international event, not only in its generation within the research laboratory and the research itself, but increasingly the use of neuroscience is not one that is limited to any one particular culture. Our information about the brain, what it does, and what that information means is being spread ever more broadly on the international stage. And there are those predictions, not speculations, predictions based upon current trends in the brain sciences, that by 2025, the majority of brain science research and its various applications will occur outside the West. Outside the West. Which means that we need to be appreciative of the ways that various cultures need the information and tools of the brain sciences, and how they use them. And what that then does is that opens a much larger window of what neuroethics may need to appreciate and how it may need to engage it. Come with me for a few moments because I want to tantalize you with some of the issues that neuroethics flirts with coming out of the brain sciences. Perhaps one of the most important is this, the use of various assessment techniques. How do brains function? What we can do is we can take a look at brain science as essentially doing three major things, three easy letters to remember, A, and A. We access the brain, we assess the brain, and we seek to affect the brain. But in accessing and assessing the brain, we're also making particular claims, definitive claims and perhaps predictive claims about what patterns of brain activity mean, perhaps none as contentious as neuroimaging. Increasingly, this field is gaining intensification, sophistication, and I think capability that allows us to have ever more granularity about the way we're able to look at brain structures and the functions that they may be involved in, if not subserve. However, I do this for a living, and I can tell you there's a lot of art that goes into these images as much as science. We have looked to these images with great hope. However, one of the things we're faced with is what do these images mean and are we using them in the right ways and good ways? Could we perhaps utilize these images to get depictions of what consciousness may look like in a brain, what pain may look like in a brain? Could we use these images perhaps to objectify subjective states? Well, that may be the hope, but it's a work in progress. And I think one of the things we need to understand is that as we stand on the edge and look into the precipice of perhaps we're trying to do these, we have to be very, very aware of the information we have and the information we lack. What do these images actually mean? What do they actually tell us? Increasingly, one of the things we've come to recognize is that these images do, in fact, provide a host of information. But the way we have to utilize these in formative ways that are actually valuable require a tremendous amount of information that then have to be compared and normalized. Enter big data. So now what we see is we link these claims about can we indeed image the brain, depict consciousness, and read, literally read, take from images meaning, read brains and minds, perhaps. But we have to have enough information and data to do that. And of course, once we open the proverbial door to big data, we engage a whole host of ethical, legal, and social questions that lead to things like probity, privacy, protection, and so forth. If we also use neuroimaging in ways that are good and right, we recognize that neuroimaging alone probably does not give us a salient or granular enough picture of the structural functional relationships we're looking to determine and define. Maybe genetics helps, and more what we're seeing is that neurogenetics is coming to the fore as a capability to interface with structures and predispositions and how these things may occur within phenotypes. A very recent development, as you may have heard, is that the company 23andMe has now opened the viability to have a genetic assay that is somewhat definitive and descriptive of predispositions to certain forms of psychiatric disorders, including depression and bipolar illness. But what does that really mean? Can we, in fact, take a look at a genetic blueprint and from that blueprint infer certain things about what this individual will become? Knowing, if you will, the relative issues that go along with neurogenetics with regard to convergence and divergence of genes, and what that then infers for probability of genes turning into phenotypes and those phenotypes actually turning into executable cognitions, emotions, and behaviors. But what we have learned is that there are certain genes that are targetable, that are not only representative, that are not only candidate, but certainly that are actually targetable, that are involved, either in a divergent or a convergent way. So the transition between what we can access and what we can assess and what we can affect then begins to hinge in a greater way than just neuroimaging that may give us viable anatomical targets of nodes and networks that may be engaged through a host of the interventional techniques I'll tell you in a moment. But here, the ability to get into the genome to be able to change these genes so as to then change the trajectory of expression of certain phenotypes, well, there's great power there. I think on the pathologic front, we can see the capability to alter genes to change what may be pathologic phenotypes. And there's hope for things like those conditions, the neuropsychiatric spectrum disorders that have been particularly problematic, to affect them. The schizophrenic spectrum disorders, for example, neurological diseases such as Parkinson's disease, Huntington's disease, and a host of others. And as a consequence, please tell me it just got light in here and I didn't have a stroke. Okay. So, and as a consequence, what ends up happening is that we can access genes in just these ways. And the question is, yeah, as we increase the capability to do so, should we? Because it's not just a question of assessing and gaining information on some type of research or medical reconnaissance mission. No. We're identifying things to target that may be indeed affectable, which is a nice politically correct way of saying manipulable. And here we move into the interventional brain sciences and what they can do. There are a number of interventional neurotechnologies that range from the relatively simple drugs, and these are getting ever more sophisticated, not only in terms of the specificity of the drug themselves, but also with the formulation of their pharmaceutics to be able to get into the brain and do what they got to do. And if, in fact, you recognize that drugs can be dirty, drugs have side effects, and even something that's fairly specific in the brain may act at multiple sites in the brain, we can move beyond that or synergize the effects of drugs through the use of both non-invasive and invasive brain stimulation. And here we run the range from those things that are exceedingly non-invasive, such as electrical transcranial stimulation and magnetic transcranial stim, all the way to things that are very highly targetable and very invasive, deep brain stimulation coupled with recording, sometimes closed loop. We can also put in various tissue grafts and genografts to modify the structure and function of the brain in ways that are directable. Clearly, we have shown this to have therapeutic benefit against a whole host of viable neuropsychiatric pathologies, but we don't stop there. Because the border between what may be pathologic and what may simply be problematic or what may be desired is simply a question of where we draw the line between what is normal and abnormal. And more what we're seeing is these interventional neurotechnological approaches, neuroscientific means, are being leveraged in such a way as to allow optimization of neurological functions in ways that may be desirable by individuals, groups, and populations. And by optimizing certain areas of neurological function, we then engage those functions as tasks, and now we're talking about performance enablement and enhancement. And of course, obviously, the questions then become, what do we do with this? And although I'd love to stand before you and say we should all hold hands, sing kumbaya, and get along, you know as well as I do that we don't. Neuroscience and neurotechnology are powerful, powerful tools. And like any powerful tool that exists in science and tech, very often those are uptaken into a variety of agendas to advance political means. And those political means can be twofold. They can be defending what you hold to be right and good, and/or executing power against others. And more what we're finding is the brain sciences have not escaped the purview of military national security intelligence and defense operations. Again, in full transparency, much of my work has been with the joint staff of the Pentagon here in the United States, with the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, and with the European Union Human Brain Project looking at dual-use brain sciences. If we take a look at the trajectory from 2008 to 2014, just in the United States alone, what we find is that the posture towards the brain sciences was initially something like, yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff there, but it's not ready for prime time. By 2012 to 2014, a report by the National Academies has declared that the brain sciences are indeed ready for prime time operational use in key areas of national security, intelligence, and defense, and more actually being used in those ways, not only by nation states, but by non-state actors. This is asymmetrical and irregular warfare taken to an entirely new plane. The brain is the next battlescape. It's not science fiction, it's real. In each and all of these domains of the ability to access, assess, and affect the brain, what we see is the cage being rattled on the limits of our capability. When we rattle the cage of capability, we literally open the door to allow the canary of ethical, legal, and social issues to fly around the room to determine whether or not we may be healthier, whether that canary is dead on the floor. And it demands a continuous reflight, not only of that canary, if you will, but of the proverbial owl of Minerva, a dawn flight, not an evening flight, a dawn flight that assesses the field as the sun rises upon the capability of neuroscience and technology, rather than as it sets upon those things we've done, and look back upon that day and say, what mistake have we made? What are the ethical issues? What are the legal issues? I have them for you here. What represents a treatment? What represents an enablement or enhancement? Who should be treated? Are there limits? What do we gain? What might we lose psychologically, socially, interpersonally, politically? This is all brand new science and technology, and although it is indeed the cutting edge, what's being cut here? What do we know? Are we in fact ready to move into applications given the novelty and the nascence of this, or do we need to do more research? How much more research? How much more information do we need? Is the only way to know to go, and what do we do for those in whom we've then taken down that road? Can we leverage neuroscience and neurotechnology in ways legal? This is an actual field called neurolaw, and increasingly what we're seeing, particularly in the psychological area, is the capability, or at least hope for the capability, to bring neuroscience into the courtroom to be able to illustrate perhaps capacity, capability, and even culpability. And then, of course, when we're looking at the way brains work and trying to establish some normative standard relative to psychology and what that means for the logos, a rational accounting of individuals' cognitions, emotions, and behaviors, we have to recognize that psychology does not exist homogeneously in the human scape. Culture plays a role. What does that then mean for cultural interpretations and uses of brain science? And even if we were to say all of this is good, what do we do about consent of those that we're going to treat and those that we're going to engage? How informed can we really be? And what are indeed the obligations that accompany any attempt to inform individuals so they can consent to the use of these techniques and technologies, either in research or in practice? What things must be in place administratively, societally, so that in fact we can utilize the brain sciences with relative confidence for those who wish to be on the cutting edge? And I'm not saying they shouldn't. Obviously, one of the things that also occurs is any and all of these boundaries are also reliant, at least in part, upon the brain sciences for some contribution to a definition of what may be normal or what may not be normal. This is what we call euneuromics. And even if we say that all of this is, once again, good, who's going to get those goodies? And what do we do about those individuals who don't? More and more, this is a real issue as we now look to the fact that a variety of nations are indeed engaging the brain sciences. How will they be used to create various dependencies, not only within their culture, of those who may be neurologically and neurotechnologically capabilized, but those who won't? But what about the ongoing international relationship between developed countries that have these techniques and technologies and developing and non-developed countries that don't? Clearly, one of the issues that must come to the fore that I urge you to appreciate and be scrupulous of when you look at the brain sciences is the responsibility for factual reporting of the information. You know, as you could tell from my accent and as I introduced you to, I come from New York City. And there was in New York City a store that was very popular called Sims. I'm not plugging any particular store, but I want to tell you about this. And they had a commercial that was popular for years, and Cy and Marcy Sims would get on and say, an educated consumer is our best customer. I think that ad should be for the brain sciences and neuroethics. Educated consumers on a variety of scales and levels, from within the research enterprise to beyond in the public sphere, is the best customer of being able to appreciate, apprehend, and engage the brain sciences in ways that are apt and good. Because more and more what we see is that there's a lot of fictional aberration of what we can and cannot do with the brain sciences, mind reading, brain control, inclusive of things that have come to the forefront. Look, Elon Musk is a brilliant man, has been highly successful. But the idea of putting a chip in everybody's head, I think, borders a little on the fictional at best, and I think on the wildly speculative, if not just wrong at worst. I'm not saying there's not a role for science fiction. We've written about it. It plays a good role. The philosophical term here is it's eidola, the idea of capturing the essence of what could be done and encapsulating that within a fictional narrative so as to be able to extrapolate what may happen in various social spheres. And we think there's something real about doing that. I think film is doing that to a good extent. We see certain films like Limitless, for example, that have done a fine job in trying to depict what neuroscience and neurotechnology could do not only for individuals, but would be the social response to that. But let's make sure we keep our fiction as fiction and our fact as fact and don't blend the two. I, like many others, truly believe that science fiction is not a portend of science fact. However, as we know, there's a lot you can do with fiction, inclusive of public engagement. And it's also important to utilize the capacity to write certain things fictional based upon a kernel of truth, which is why we've urged for neuroethical obligations to engage the humanities and the arts to be able to create viable neuroscience fiction to communicate what the horizon of probability and possibility will be for the uses of neuroscience and neurotechnologies in society. This is what neuroethics does. It is certainly scientific. It takes a look at what the science does. It anticipates and resolves these conceptual and theoretical puzzles in those ways to respect a variety of these research models as scientific, being self-critical, being self-revising, and keeping that self-critical, self-revising tone and tenor as the marching orders for any appreciation of what the brain sciences can really do and can really not do. But remember, like any good ethics, ethics is a social engagement. It's about the effort. It's about the enterprise. How will we use the brain sciences? The brain sciences, even in psychology, are not confined to the limits of the laboratory. No, no. These permeate out of these very, very open apertures of the laboratory to be used in real applications, as I started the lecture, in medicine, in the social sphere, and increasingly even in things like politics. So neuroethics must not only appreciate the scientific realities of brain science and its limits, but must also appreciate the pulling forces of the social sphere and those ways guide the apt and good uses of neuroscience, particularly in areas where we begin to take a look at human thought, emotion, and behavior vis-a-vis psychology. My colleague John Shook and I have developed something of a principled approach that builds upon the four principles, but takes them one step higher to appreciate that as we move ahead with brain sciences, as we will, as a juggernaut with momentum, we may need to appreciate that new principles may need to be developed and others revised so as to enable a little bit more flexible orientation to the way we apply the brain sciences in a variety of fields, from the scientific to the social. Principles such as self-creativity, non-obsolescence, empowerment, and citizenship, and each are all important, not prima facie, not stand alone, but interdigitatively to work cooperatively. And I like the word cooperation because as we take neuroethics and we turn neuroethics as lens and mirror upon neuroscience, and then turn both of those onto the fact that these will be used increasingly in various domains and dimensions of society, we see that this field of neuroethics is not just a field of hyphenated ethics, but it's coming of age. And the nice thing about coming of age, per the quote, is you can do whatever you'd like. The question then becomes, what will neuroethics, and those of us who do neuroethics, want to do? And I think this is important because as we face the future, it will be important for neuroethics, vis-a-vis its work with neuroscience and balancing that work with neuroscience in the fields that use it in the social dimensions, to take a maturational stance, to avoid these mere imitations of youth where it's imitating other fields and to take on its own character, and equally to avoid the impulsiveness of adolescence. You know, there's an interesting quote from Pinocchio, and I'll read it to you. I usually impugn anyone who reads a PowerPoint, but I'll read this one to you. To become real, you must prove to be brave, truthful, and honest. Brave to recognize what you really know and what you don't, and to take those steps forward to sometimes utilize new techniques and technologies and to avoid using others. Truthful to recognize the veridicality of what's there and what isn't, and honest with yourself and those people who you deal with to say we simply don't know and perhaps we shouldn't go. And that's important because it establishes this triangulation of psychology, brain science, and neuroethics not as mutual puppeteering, not as pulling each other's strings where now neuroscience pulls the strings of psychology or neuroethics pulls the strings of neuroscience, or perhaps each and all of them are puppeteered by various social agenda and pulling forces of the market and politics. No, no, no. We're going to avoid that kind of Pinocchioism. The goal here is if, in fact, we're going to do this in a way that is both technically apt and ethical, legally, and socially sound, what we're really looking for is the interaction of psychology, brain science, and this guiding and governing field of neuroethics to be cooperative, mutually supportive partnership. To do just these things, as I have for you here in this interesting little slide, that determines that there must be mutual inspiration. The questions of psychology can be posed to neuroscience, and the questions of psychology and neuroscience can be posed to neuroethics, and neuroethical questions can be posed to both. A sharing of information and a sharing of capability, I think, is critical, that this then builds trust that the information we're getting is apt, is sound, and will be used in the right ways. These things need to be negotiated in terms of how they're being utilized in the various spheres of application. And ultimately, the pushing force needs to be benefit in a cooperative way, in a way that is well-informed. Clearly, I think that this represents the ideal of how we should move forward. As a philosopher, I was trained by the late Edmund Pellegrino of Georgetown University. And one of the things that Ed liked to do was to take a look at what ethics was doing and what it wasn't doing and sort of try to negotiate and navigate the scope in between. Ed didn't deal much with neuroethics. One of the reasons he brought me to Georgetown was to develop that program. I'm very grateful and thankful not only to Ed, but to Georgetown for doing that. Because one of the things that he would say over and over again is in these questions of personhood, free behavior, a lot of the techniques and technologies that medicine has developed are, in fact, important. And that matter may be explicable in terms of chemistry, but perhaps mind and purpose are not. It leaves a wide space open for neuroethics. That the next decades will bring even greater challenges as we develop these technologies. And the issue here is, how shall we work to achieve these human goals? Those words are Ed's, but this concluding one is mine. That reflection, insight, and some type of moral engagement, perhaps pause, must be stepping stones for each and all of our acts of inquiry, equally in psychology and neuroscience, that neuroethics may look to be able to guide and govern, so that in fact we see that these acts of inquiry, intervention, innovation, each and all are done in ways that are indeed technically sound, but equally ethical, legally, and socially at least addressed, deliberated upon, and good. I thank you for your time. I provide you with some additional readings. And if, in fact, you're interested in getting in touch with me, that's where you can find me. Thank you so much. I think we have time for perhaps one quick question. Yes, sir. Sure. In other words, if in fact what I'm doing is I'm utilizing some neuroscientific approach or technology to create an individual who is in some way enabled or enhanced, is developing capabilities in a particular area, I cannot then make other individuals in that population obsolete. So here what I see is non-obsolescence not only for an individual, a group of individuals, but it comports well with the other principle here, which is citizenship. If I'm empowering me or a group of individuals, I cannot do so in a way that renders others obsolete. But by the same token, I cannot be rendered obsolete, so I have to keep the individual available and open for continuity of clinical research and clinical care, so that if I'm getting version 1.0 of something, I should have the opportunity to get version 2.0, 3.0, et cetera, as the techniques and technologies increase. One more question? Yes, sir? Yeah, I mean, it's more of a statement of fact, and I think you can't do ethics without economics. I mean, the eco there is your household, and appreciating the strong pulling forces of the market is dramatic. The question will become, what will we do with those individuals who are neurocapably enhanced or capabilized and those who are not? And are we really looking at a situation where the haves and have-nots become discriminately broader and broader and broader in the schism between? It's a real danger that certainly represents a focus of neuroethics. We have to clear the room. I thank you very much. I'll be in the back of the room if you want more questions. So happy to meet all of you. Thank you very much.